E.G. Bellin. With support from Sir Henry Tizard, they overcame political hostility and technical teething problems. Their story is vividly told by Dr. Byrne in his book, Radar Days. Put very simply, CH transmitted powerful pulsed radio waves which were reflected by aircraft in the sky. The time delay between the transmitted pulse and receiving its reflection back at the station indicated the aircraft's range from the station. This CH station at Worth Matravers on the Dorset coast near Swanage was rather special. The site also housed the radar research teams from Bawdsey, who arrived in 1940 after a short stay in Dundee. The teams, with colleagues who joined later, were to invent and develop the brilliant ground and airborne radar systems that played such a vital role in winning the war. We'll stay with CH and look at a film made at Worth in 1940, where filmmaking facilities were primitive to say the least. But it's the commentary style that's so excruciating today. An RAF pilot who saw the film recently said, "It's a good example of how we were talked down to early in the war."
You've seen this before. You know what it is, don't you? It's an echo from one aircraft all by itself. Let's have a look at it on a real tube at a station. There it is, beneath the pointer. Steady as a rock. Of course, it doesn't always look as neat and simple as this, as there are often all sorts of untidy, stray noises about, which make the tube pattern look an awful mess. Like this. But your echo is there, all the time. That one beneath the pointer at 30 miles. And it's steady. Doesn't change its size at all. You ought to be able to recognize this echo now. And remember, it always means one single craft. You may get two of these steady echoes at different places on the tube. That's to say at two different ranges. It's quite simple. Twice one at two. Two separate crafts. But what do you make of this? Ever seen an echo doing this before? Now watch it. It's swinging gracefully up and down, keeping almost in perfect rhythm. See? We call it a beating echo. It's this sort of echo we get from two craft in formation. And it does this swing high, swing low act because the two craft can't possibly keep perfect formation. In fact, they're always doing this sort of thing. Once again, we'd better see what it really does look like on the station tube. Here it is, just beneath the white pointer, swinging up and down. Try and forget all about the jitters. But just a minute. Supposing there are two separate craft, both at the same range from the receiver, but on different thetas. Then both echoes will happen at the same place on the tube. Now we will get a swinging echo just like the other one. That's rather confusing, isn't it? How do we know if we've got a formation of two, or just two separate ones at the same range? Well, the best way to tell is by DFing rather slowly. If your swinging echo goes right down to nothing as you DF, swinging all the time, like this, it's a formation. But if the swinging stops as you DF, like this, so you're left with a steady echo, like this, it simply means that you've got two separate craft at the same range, but on different thetas, and you've DF'd one of them out. You can do just the same thing at another gonio setting, and DF the other one out. Now look at this fellow, jigging up and down in this queer dancing way. This is the kind of echo you generally get from three craft flying in fairly close formation. Or four, five, and even six, sometimes. Let's look at the real thing on the station. There it is, the one under the pointer. Pretty much the same if you forget all about the jittery bumps and things. This echoes from three battles. And this one here, from five hurricanes. Watch how this echo is jigging unsteadily, not swinging gracefully like the one from two craft did. Now there's an important thing about this jigging echo. Watch it. Do you see that in spite of the jigging, it's a single echo all the time? There's only one peak to it. You'll see why this is important in a minute. Remember, this echo generally comes from three, four, five, and perhaps six craft in close formation. But when we get to bigger formations, say nine or more, we begin to get echoes that look rather different from the ones we've just seen. Look at the bottom of this echo. Do you see how it is split up into separate peaks, bobbing up and down on their own? You hardly ever get these little separate peaks, like a bunch of bananas, with less than about six craft in close formation. If you see them on an echo, you can be pretty certain you've got a fairly large formation, nine or more. Or sometimes you may get them running up and down the sides of the echo, like this. It's just the same. And there's another way of telling these echoes from larger formations. They are either wider, like this, or else deeper, like this. Suppose we've got a biggish formation flying like this, or like this. You can see that the nearest plane is at a much closer range than the furthest one. So our echo will be spread out across the time base. It will be much wider than the echo you get from a small formation. And here we are on the station tube. Look at this wide echo from 24 Blenheim. Compare it with this narrow one from 3. Or suppose our big formation is flying like this. Or like this. Then, though the planes are all pretty much at the same range, our echo will be much deeper than from a small formation because there are so many more craft to reflect the echo. Back on the station tube, we get this from 20 Blenheims at 30 miles. Instead of this from 3 Blenheims, also at 30 miles. It still jigs up and down, but how much farther down? And, although it's thin, it's still got the little separate peaks of its own. Now, with a wide echo, like this, you can actually count the little peaks. And as a rough rule, each separate peak means about three craft. But with a narrow, deep echo like this, you can't count the peaks, so you've only got the depth to go on. Now let's go over all this again. Study this very carefully now. A single, steady echo like this means one craft. An echo swinging up and down like this usually means two craft. But there's just one thing to remember here, which we've not yet said anything about. You know that a good many stations have permanent echoes, given by hills, or even big buildings, like this one. Well, these echoes naturally stay put, always. But if you're unlucky enough to get a single craft at the same range as your wretched hill, or gasworks, then the two echoes will come together and start swinging, just like two craft. Still, if you know your own permanent echoes by heart, this shouldn't worry you. An echo jigging up and down like this, but with only one peak to it, means a small number of craft flying in fairly close formation. An echo like this, wider, or like this, deeper, and with little peaks of its own, like this, usually means a bigger formation. All quite clear? Fine. But don't be afraid of reporting a wrong number, especially at long range. You may have to alter your report when the formation gets nearer. If in doubt at all, better to report too many rather than too few.
The years 1940 to 42 saw tremendous strides in the evolution of radar. New ground and airborne systems were invented and developed at Worth, as were ingenious methods of fooling enemy radar. As they evolved, many of the prototypes and early models were flight tested in aircraft flown from RAF Christchurch near Bournemouth. In his book, Angel Visits, Frank Griffiths, who was a pilot with special duty flight at RAF Christchurch, wrote, "Life at Christchurch was hectic, totally absorbing and marvelously interesting. Strange men would appear, cut holes in aeroplanes, and stick odd-looking aerials on them." Or cut off the nose of an aircraft to install such things as a large saucer-shaped scanner. During this splendid period, many famous radar devices were born and brought to an operational state, such as G, the navigational aid, Rebecca Eureka, a homing device, H2S, the airborne radar which gave a visual presentation of ground features through cloud and darkness, ASV, surface vessel location, and other war winners. We flew whenever the weather was fit, and often when it was unfit, for we had magnificent ground equipment to control us from Worth and from Sopley, an experimental ground control interception station. The TRE teams obviously developed a great rapport with the RAF at Christchurch. The pilots in particular are remembered with affection. Douglas Raymond, Wilbur Wright, Blokey Appleton, Slogger Slocum, and of course, Griff, Frank Griffiths. Of this period, A.P. Rowe said, "If the Germans had bombed us then, the effect on the war would have been tremendous." In future videos, we hope to look in detail at AI, ASV, G, H2S, Oboe, and other major achievements which have had a profound effect on the course of the war. No less important to the units involved was a radar beacon which, from 1942 to 45, was used in clandestine operations to supply the partisans in eight countries and to assist the Allies to retake Europe. The system was known as Rebecca Eureka. It was originated and developed at TRE by J.W.S. Pringle, R. Hanbury Brown and their team. Our simple film of an early version was made at RAF Netheravon on Salisbury Plain in 1942. It was made as a silent film, but we've replaced the captions with a commentary in the same style. Rebecca Eureka uses a radar beacon, Eureka, which is carried by the advance party. Eureka has a transmitter and receiver. Rebecca, the airborne interrogator, also has a transmitter and receiver, and an indicator unit. Rebecca transmits 300 pulses a second, which are received by Eureka and transmitted back to Rebecca in the aircraft, where the range and bearing of the individual Eureka beacons can be followed by the navigator on his indicator unit. This is the Eureka transmitter receiver. A heavy-duty nickel-iron battery provides the power which is converted by the power unit to correct values for the transmitter receiver. The aerial is mounted on a telescopic stand. For our exercise, Rebecca is fitted to a Halifax bomber. Power for Rebecca is produced by a generator on the starboard inner engine. The supply is controlled by a voltage control panel connected to the Rebecca transmitter receiver. This is Rebecca's transmitter aerial, the port receiver aerial, and the starboard receiver aerial. Conventional cables connect the aerials to the transmitter receiver unit. The indicator unit, as we've said, gives a visual presentation of the range and bearing of the Eureka beacon. The system is pre-tuned to a set of frequencies which are selected by rotary switches on Eureka and press buttons on the Rebecca control unit. The Eureka items are packed into a special kit bag. Packing is rather torturous. But remember, the equipment is about to be dropped from an aircraft attached to a parachutist, and we are dealing with comparatively delicate equipment and a very heavy battery. Once over the target, the Eureka operator jumps with a kit bag strapped to his legs. In the air, he pulls a quick release. The bag falls away but remains suspended a few feet below him on a rope attached to his parachute harness. Both Rebecca and Eureka operators must use the correct pre-arranged frequencies for their particular operation. Obviously, a mismatch in channel selection would wreck the operation. In our exercise, the Eureka receiver is set at channel A, and the transmitter at channel B. The operator checks his Eureka by pressing the noise button. If all's well, he'll hear a harsh note in his headphones. Reinforcements take off. Inside the Halifax, the radio operator switches on the Rebecca power supply. The navigator switches on the transmitter. Remember, the Eureka receiver was set at channel A, so the Rebecca transmitter must also be set at channel A. Similarly, the Eureka transmitter was set at channel B, so the Rebecca receiver must be set at channel B. The image on the navigator's indicator shows the range and bearing of the Eureka beacon. The transparent scale has two sets of calibrations. This is the 0 to 36 mile scale. And this one indicates 0 to 9 miles or 0 to 90 miles. This CRT trace is on the 90 mile scale and shows the Eureka beacon dead ahead at 65 miles. The navigator switches to the 36 mile scale. As the pilot turns to port, this is what the navigator sees. The asymmetrical blip indicates that the aircraft has moved off course. The pilot is directed back on course. He turns to starboard. but overcorrects. Another word from the navigator, and the Halifax is back on course for the beacon. At a range of about 8 miles, the navigator switches to the 9-mile scale. When our Rebecca aircraft is within range, the normal harsh note heard by the Eureka operator changes to a 300 Hz tone. When the note changes, the Eureka operator can send a simple message to the Rebecca operator in Morse code. For example, the letter W, dot, dash, dash. There it is on the navigator's indicator. The arrival of reinforcements completes our exercise. During the war, radar security was paramount. If the enemy captured Rebecca or Eureka equipments intact, he could soon produce interference to disable the system. For example, this is the effect of CW interference transmitted on a Rebecca frequency. To avoid the capture of intact equipment, provision was made to destroy vital circuits. Rebecca could be blown up by pressing these two buttons simultaneously. And Eureka was blown up by detonating an explosive charge threaded through the circuits. Quite effective. Within a year, Eureka had been dramatically reduced in size and weight. Rebecca, too, had become much more compact and less power-hungry. New miniature valves from the USA had helped in this transformation. It had now become possible to use Rebecca in gliders. So it was fitted to some of the troop transporting gliders used for the Allied invasion of Europe. In 1942, TRE was hurriedly moved away from Worth Matravers inland to Malvern. Reasons for the dramatic move and the choice of Malvern are another good story for the future. At Malvern, TRE grew rapidly to meet the needs of the RAF for more and improved radar devices. At the peak, around 4,000 scientists, technicians, engineers and support staff were employed at TRE. New huts sprang up around the college grounds. And TRE's flying operations moved to Defford, near Worcester.